just a prayer away. All you need to do is call. He will hear your faintest cry. He's concerned about you. So while your tears are flowing through your time of mourning, He is here to lift your heavy heart, 'cause He's in love with you. He knows, He cares, He sees, He's there. He'll carry you. He's concerned about you.
Weeping may endure for a night, but the morning will bring joy. He won't give you more than you can bear. He's concerned about you. He loves you, oh yeah.
About you. He knows, He cares, He sees, He's there, and He'll carry you. He's concerned about you. About you, He's concerned about you. He's concerned about
you've never been closer than you are right now.
testing.
You are glad?
Yeah. Good. No, but we fell up because I'm a new church.
But we ain't doing it.
I ain't nothing about it, you know that?
People watch.
I am the resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. The eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. If we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after I die, worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. Let us pray. Father, remind us as we gather for this memorial that none of us live to himself and none of us dies to himself. We are yours, whether we are living in this life or whether we have passed into the life beyond. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, for they rest from their labor. You give, you take away. Blessed be the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And everybody shouted, amen. We are going to invite a group of beautiful ladies from the Barbados Lighting Power Company Limited to lead us in the singing. Somebody give a hands clap for them as they come. Encourage somebody. Hallelujah. Thank you. Tamara Carrington is going to read the first lesson for us, after which we're going to have our second song, Goodness of God.
No, here. Right there.
Good morning. This reading is taken from Revelation 21, verses 1 to 7. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them, and he will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give you water without cost from the spring of water of life. To those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." Here ends the reading.
Faithful.
Second lesson is going to be read by Neil King and Shakedia King. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 to 32.
Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail.
They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness.
I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him.
The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him.
It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord.
It is good for a man to bear the yoke. Well, he is young.
Let him sit alone in silence, for the Lord has laid it on him.
Let him bury his face in the dust, there may yet be hope.
Let him offer his cheek to one who will strike him, and let him be filled with grace.
For no one is cast off by the Lord forever.
Though he brings grief, he will show compassion. So great is his unfailing love.
You may be seated. Shauna Mitchell is going to come and read a letter to Dwayne. Somebody clap your hands for her. Come, Rachel. Come. Look. Come. We want to hear you, so.
Morning. It was the music. If anyone knew you, they knew you loved music. And it's the music that made me fall so deeply in love with you. Your happiness came, especially when you got the set hooked up just right, that the bass note would shake every building you passed, and you knew Dwayne was coming for Shauna or picking up Darren or Summary. Life is so funny. We lived a gap away from each other our entire childhood, and we never met. It was only as adults and by sheer coincidence, our love for the gym. I can still recall my heart singing next to you each time you worked out, and you never once telling me to shut up because I was definitely off key. I remember we had some escapades, and if only Tony knew how much times we skipped gym. I always remember everyone said to me that you changed me completely, and I can say that you truly did. It was not only as a person, but in teaching me how to truly love someone. You loved me through everything. I told you about my past, and you never once judged me for it. You showed me how to become a better person through the challenges that happened in my life, because just like me, you had to overcome your own as well. I knew that I had found the right person to spend my life with. As I watched the way you treated your mom, you loved her unconditionally and you respected her. Your love and respect was enough for me to know that I had been blessed by you coming into my life. Your true measure as a man showed when you became a father both times around. You would do anything to make sure both me and our children were happy. You would sacrifice for the three of us. You always found a way to provide regardless of what was happening around us. You made sure you were there for every event, especially when I couldn't make it. I look forward to all the pictures and the videos I received whenever you, Darren, and Samaria had your times together. I know how much you love being a father, and I'm so honored that I was able to provide you with such a great role. You were a loving uncle and brother. Everything out of Jeremy's mouth is Uncle Dwayne this and Uncle Dwayne that, and I want to go by Uncle Dwayne. You and Samantha have this bond that is unbreakable. and you care for her like the big brother, even though she's older. She never made a decision without your input. I love to watch your interaction with Samantha on the phone. Regardless of if she called you at work or home, you two would just ramble on and on, like you didn't see each other or was away for months and no catching up. I'm honored that you gave me another sister, and I promise to cherish her forever. You were never boastful. You were trustworthy, friendly, fun-loving, responsible, and respectful. You always listened without judging and then gave your take on any situation. You just had this aura that people just opened up and told you everything. Anyone that knew you as a person loved you. They never had an unkind word to say once your name was mentioned. You were down to earth, peaceful, and always willing to lend a helping hand in any way you could. You would never know you were upset because it never showed. One thing that I must say that I admired about you, babe, is how you could build anything once you put your mind to it. If you said you wanted a birdhouse, believe that birdhouse built and it will build. If you heard a noise on the car or even someone else, guaranteeing you could tell them what's wrong and you would be right. You could fix anything you put your mind to. You have some exceptional skills. And the one skill I will miss is your baking, especially the banana and sweet bread. You could bake some beautiful cakes and you always shared it with whomever you could, especially your work colleagues. I remember when you started working at Luton Power and you were so happy because you finally found something that you could put your mark on, and you did just that. You taught so much life's work in there, and everyone will miss your presence. Even when you would go to Automotive Arts, it was like you never left. You were always greeted pleasantly. I miss you, plain and simple. I miss everything about you. I didn't just lose my husband, I lost my best friend. I don't know who to talk to because I tell you every single thing from when to iodine. I never once felt uncomfortable telling you anything because we will always have a good laugh after, especially at my silliness. I keep replaying the last conversation we had, and I still can't believe that would be it. What do I do from here? I didn't know how to be me without you. You were my Clyde. We did everything together. You knew my routine, I knew yours. I promise to take care of these two beautiful gifts you left me with and show them daily how much you love them. If heaven has a telephone, tell them to keep the line free, cause I plan to call every day to fill you in on everything. P.S. I finally got my license. My only regret is not being able to be your chauffeur. But you're in my heart, so you're right with me every day.
Please stand.
We're going to give these ladies a new name today. We're going to call them the Barbados Light and Power Company Limited Singers. Somebody clap your hands for them. Isn't that good? Amen. We are glad to have them. You may please be seated. My name is Lester Morrill. I'm the pastor of this church. I've been here for a long, long time. I've been here for 37 years, and I expect to have another 37. I'm always in this man's life. A few months after I came here in 1986, I christened him. I'm using that word christen. We don't use it in Pentecostal church, but for you to understand, I say I christened him then. And then last year sometime, I married him. And now today, the unfortunate task of having to bury him. So it seems as though I'm always in his life, but I'm not going to be with him right now. This is where it cuts off. I mean, no. I'm not going to be with him. Look, on behalf of the Archer family and all the other families and those who are mourning and grieving and friends and loved ones and workmates, you may call them colleagues, I want to take the opportunity on their behalf to say thanks to you for taking the time out today to come and pay your last respects to the family of the deceased. And I would like to offer my personal condolences and the condolences of this church, because the Archers family, their navel string is buried in this place. So we want to offer condolences to them and be with them at this time of grief and sorrow. Who loves to go through this? Nobody. So to the Archer families and all the other families that I do not know, I just want to extend condolences to you. And by the way, I have a message for you. Somebody asked me to pass on a message to you ever since. I didn't know where to find you. But I'm glad you're here this morning, because at last I could pass on this message to you. As a matter of fact, I haven't seen you for so long that the messages keep on building up and building up. And I'm going to try my best to give you as many, because I don't know when I'm going to see you again. And it's going to be like, you're going to have some visuals on the screen. I know you don't normally see that at funerals, but we at the Pegwell Community Church, we try to be different. And if you're in transition, moving from one church to the other, Pegwell Community Church is a good place to come. If you're looking for a church at the beginning and you don't have any place, the Pegwell Community Church is a good place to come. Tonight will not be too early, because we have prayer meeting tonight where we go before the face of God and talk to him about a number of things. So thanks for coming. So let me start off with some of these messages that somebody asked me to send to you, to tell you. And the first one, they're going to be found in the Bible. They're recording. And the first one we're going to have is a message from Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27. Because I want to remind you of a few things. Perhaps you haven't been in church for a long time. Perhaps you may not be in church again before Christmas. Maybe you wouldn't have a chance to come back at all. So let me tell you some things that I've been asked to pass on to you. Somebody has asked me to tell you, I hope you know that his name is Jesus Christ. He's asked me to tell you that it is appointed unto men once to die, and after that, the judgment. Now, you ladies can cancel your appointment with the nail technician. You can cancel your appointment with the doctor. You can cancel your appointment with anybody. But this is an appointment. If you could talk to him, he would tell you. This is an appointment that you cannot cancel. We live as though we can. And the more educated we become, and the more rich we become, or the richer, whatever you want to use, it seems as though we think that we are going to live forever. Somebody sent me a picture the other day of two graves together, one of Bill Gates and the other one of a pauper. They were the same size, they were the same depth. Because it doesn't matter what you have in this life, and we should get all that we can in this life, but we got to put it in its right perspective. So it seems as though when people become educated and wealthy, they don't worry with these ignorant people up here at this church. I wish the church will fall down on them. The rain fall on them going to church. Them ain't got nothing to do. Well, you know why we do that? We do that because we've read the book, and we know what the end is going to be like. So the Lord is saying to us today, to everybody, is appointed unto man once a day. The death rate is 100%. Everybody is going to die. You are going to die as well. So this was a good message that was sent to you. that is appointed unto men once today, and after that the judgment, and the appointment you cannot cancel. You cannot cancel. It doesn't matter. So what's going to happen after we face this judgment? But a number of things, we don't have enough time this morning to tell you. You may want to call this sermon Funeral 101, because we don't even have enough time. But let me remind you that when we die, we are either going one place or the other, heaven or hell. How do you determine where you go? Let me tell you. I've been asked to pass on this message to you. I've been asked to tell you that you were born in sin, so you're a sinner. You're a sinner because you were born in sin. The Bible says that in Psalms 51 and verse 5, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." So because you're born in sin, all of us are sinners. We can't get to heaven as sinners. So we've got to do something about it. You know, the Bible also says in Ecclesiastes chapter 7 verse 20, "For there's not a just man upon the earth that doeth good and sinneth not." We are all sinners, so we are all condemned to a devil's hell. Don't get scared about the word hell. It is Jesus who introduced the word hell in the Bible, not me. So we're going to talk about that in a little while. But Romans chapter 5 and verse 12 said, "Wherefore, as by one man, Adam, sin entered into the world, and death because of sin, so death has passed on to all men, for all have sinned." And then we read that the wages, Romans 6:23, that the wages of sin is death. But then you don't have to go down that road. You could go down another road that says, but the gift of God is eternal life. So it's your choice to accept the wages, which means that you earn that. The wages of sin is death. But the Lord has given us an alternative. But the gift of God is eternal life. Although you should know what sin is, and I don't have this in my notes, let me give you a little upgrade. Galatians chapter 5, verse 19. Let's see the sins that the Lord says will keep us out of heaven. Galatians chapter 5. They're called the works of the flesh. The works of the flesh. And this is the Lord said, so let's go to verse 21 and read the end first and come back. Verse 21. Verse 21 said at the end, the very end, the last three lines, "They which do such things will not see heaven," will not go to heaven, will not see God's face. Did you see those three lines there? Somebody's going to put them in red in a minute. "They which do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God." What are these things? What are these things? Go back to verse 21. "They that do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." What are these things? Verse 21. Adultery. Fornication, leave the man wife alone, leave the woman husband alone. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, those are the sex sins. But it goes on. Idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, always that variance to somebody, emulations, wrath or violence, strife, seditions, heresies, it continues, envyings, murders, with an S at the end, because if you hate your brother, you're a murderer. Drunkenness, you've got to get a little something from the bottle all the time. Revelings, which is wild party like Kadumun. Them people don't go twerk down on the highway, them more than anybody else. No, we do that because the Bible said revelings is the work of the flesh, and it continues. Paul said, "I told you before, and I'm telling you weeping now, that they who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God." Am I sound like I'm quarreling? I am. Because I want you to get this message. Amen? That it is, you only have one chance to make it to heaven or hell. And that chance finishes when you die. There's no purgatory. You don't go put money in some tray and believe that somebody's going to pray or the purgatory and you have a second chance. No, we all have one chance. One chance to make it into life eternal or to make it into hell. So the wages of sin is death. That's your choice. God has given us the power of choice. And in church, we don't try to get anybody to make a different choice. You make the choice that you want. You probably decide you don't want to read the Bible because it is a white man's book that is designed to put black people in bondage. That might be your take on it. That's your choice. Fine. Hallelujah. But we've read the book and we know that it should not be like that. So the thing that you can do is do like most of us have done. We've decided that we're going to ask Jesus to come into our lives, change our lives, make us ready for heaven, make us ready for an eternity that is real, real, real nice. Well, I wish I had a long time. I wish I was preaching in China today, because in China, if you preach for less than 9 hours, you haven't said anything. Because of the underground church, they don't get a chance to meet so often. So they're in caves and whatever. And 9 hours is about the standard time. I wish I had that time now to deliver this message to you that I've been asked to pass on to you. So let's talk about heaven. Let's talk about hell. What is heaven like? I could take 2 sermons, 3 sermons to tell you what heaven is like. But Revelation chapter 7 verse 17 tells you that heaven is a place where God will wipe away all tears from your eyes. The Bible talks about a new Jerusalem that is 15 miles long, 1500 miles long, 1500 miles wide, 1500 miles high. It's like a cube. Revelation 21 talks about it coming down from heaven, and it's beautiful. The Bible talks about the precious stones with which it is made. In Revelation chapter 21 and verse 4, you will like this. It tells us that when you go to heaven, number one, God will wipe away all tears from your eyes. I'll be glad. I'll be glad about that. And then the Bible says there'll be no more death. There'll be no more sorrow. There'll be no more crying. Neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away. At this point, if we were having a regular service, I would pray for you now because of your pain. Why? James chapter 5 and verse 14. The Lord tells us as a church, we should do that. And the church that you're doing should do that. Is there any sick among you? Look what they should do. Call for the elders of the church. Let the elders of the church pray over him. You could come tonight. Anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And what will happen? And the prayer of faith shall save or deliver the sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. So that is what we do in church. We pray. So there will be no more crying, no more sorrow, no more death. I don't understand how somebody could really reject this. I don't understand how people could turn away from this. It is a life of bliss in heaven. It's a life of happiness. In John chapter 14, the Lord said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Man, when you get to heaven, all the trials and the tribulations that you had here on this life, they're all going to be worth it. A songwriter said, it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. It will be worth it all when we see him. One glimpse of his dear face and all of our sorrows will erase. So let us continue to run this race until we see him. Who knows when your time is going to come? Who knows when your judgment day is going to come? Who knows? The Bible says so many other things concerning heaven, but I really want to jump down to talk a little bit about hell, because some people say, you know, dumb Pentecostal preachers always talking about hell, trying to frighten people into hell. Man, if I could do that, I would start right now. Because when you learn about hell, you don't want your pet poodle to go there. When you learn about what hell is, you don't want even your worst enemy to go there. And if I could frighten you into hell, we can't. Otherwise, all churches would be full by now. We can't, but if I could, I would spend all my days trying to frighten you. That's the word you guys use, frighten you into heaven. Let me show you something from Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. And this is where all persons will go who decide either arrogantly or ignorantly that they don't want Jesus. I don't want any Jesus. You keep your Jesus. When we were in Bible school and we used to witness in Boston, people on the street would spit at you and say, can you wait Jesus someplace else? Okay, fine. Choice is yours. But this was going to happen. After you die, or you go to, this body goes to the grave. But what about your soul and your spirit? Man is made up of body, soul, and spirit. This is the body that is going up to the Christ Church 70 right now. But what about your soul and your spirit? Job said a long time ago, and the book of Job is supposed to be the first book of the Bible, they say, Job said, after worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh. That sounds like a paradox. Yet in my flesh, I'm going to see God. How in your flesh you're going to see God when the worms just destroy your body? Because you see, you're coming back again. Just like Jesus was raised from the dead. All of us are going to be raised from the dead one of these days. And we're going to have different bodies. We're going to have incorruptible bodies. You can read that in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're going to have bodies that would not decay again. They're going to have special bodies. But let's look at this. Let's look at this story of hell. And I'm not going to bore you anymore with this. But I think it is important because, Luke chapter 16, I'm going to begin at verse 19. There was a certain rich man. And for those of you who preach, understand that when Jesus is speaking a parable, he says, I give you a parable. This is not a parable because he didn't say it was a parable. He said there was a certain rich man. This is a man that Jesus knew. This is a man that Jesus knew. Pay close attention, children, students. There was a rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fresh sumptuously every day. Pause there, don't change until I tell you. Huh? In other words, he had his big job and his BMW and his Mercedes and taking caviar and all the best things. He lived in a gated community. But in the next verse, I'm going to tell you the opposite. Right outside of his gated community, there was a poor man. Listen carefully. There was a beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores. If you were in church this morning, now I would tell you wave at me if you understand what I'm saying. So you have the picture in your mind. The man in the gated community, with all that life could offer, at his gate, there's a man that is so poor that the Bible says in the next verse that even the dog came and licked his sores. Now, let me give you a little something here. It says, and moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Please, don't preach that the dog's name was moreover. Somebody get mixed up and say, well, the dog's name was moreover. No. And moreover, the dog came and licked his sores. So you have that picture in your mind. Let's see what happened next. This man, go back. Verse 21, this man was just desiring to be fed with the crumbs that fell from that rich man's table. When he drove out in his BMW and Mercedes, he could have thrown a banana. He could have thrown out an apple. The man just wanted the crumbs from his table. Just the crumbs the man wanted. But he's driving out, press his button, the gate open, press his button, it's closed, and the man is right there. But look what happened. Look what happened. Verse 22, it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. That's a good place. That's a place you went before you went to heaven. That's like a holding place. He went to Abraham's bosom, but the rich man also died and was buried. Am I saying you shouldn't be rich? No, I wish I were rich now. Get all the riches you can, but put it in the right perspective, because one of these days, there's an appointment that you got to keep and you can't cancel it. So no matter what we get in life, remember the appointment. And you only have one chance. You can't change it. You can't change it. You only have one chance. But look at this. It came to pass that the beggar died, and he was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom, and the rich man also died and was buried. The narrative continues, and it's interesting. And in hell, notice that I didn't talk about hell, it's Jesus. In hell, he lifted up his eyes. So in hell you can see. Oh, you thought that your body just went up to the Christ Church and that was all. You think your body just went to the cemetery and that's all. No, no, no. In hell he could see. He lifted up his eyes, being in torments. In hell is not a staycation. In hell is not at a 7-star hotel. Hell is a place of torments. If you don't serve Jesus, that's the only other alternative. You don't have more choices, one or the other. That's why we come to church. That's why we read Humps and Grumps. That's why we let you curse us. That's why we let you call us hypocrites. That's why we bear all that we got to bear, you know, and give money to the church so that we can spread it. We bear all that because we read things like this. Being in torments, and he saved Abraham afar off so he could recognize. He recognized somebody from the former life. He sees Abraham afar off, and he sees Lazarus in Abraham's bosom. It's going to get more interesting. Are you with me so far? Look what happens next. And he cried so he could talk. This young man can't talk now, but in hell he could talk. It's not that your body just goes down there and can't go serve the Lord, come and get the grave, get the grave. No. It doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. There's something called eternity. Take them. And by the way, let me tell you what eternity is like. This is a very, maybe a stupid example, but it proves the point. You're going to either spend eternity in heaven or eternity in hell. Somebody who wanted to prove a point, gave us an example of eternity, how long eternity is. And he said that the sun is 93 million miles away from here. If you could get a bird that could fly with one grain of sand from here to the moon, drop it off and come back, you know that would take years. He picks up another one, takes it up to the sun, drops it off and come back. And he does that. When all the grains of sand on the earth, I didn't say Barbados, I didn't say the Caribbean, when all the grains of sand on the earth are transported to the sun, eternity would have just begun. And that is the time you will spend in heaven with the Lord. I don't know about you, but I go in there. Or you could spend with the devil in torments. So let's look at this verse again. He saw Abraham being in torments, and he said, Abraham, have mercy on me. He's asking for mercy from the wrong place. Ask for mercy now. Ask for mercy now. That he may dip the finger, because there's no water in hell, dip his finger and come and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. So hell is a place of flames. It's a place of torment. But this man is shameless. You pass Lazarus every day, and you didn't even give him a Zephyrin bread. But now you find yourself in hell. You want the same Lazarus that you pass by every day, and would not even give him the crumb from your table. Now you want him to dip his finger in water and come and cool your tongue. Some people are just shameless. Somebody asked me to send this message to you. You should have come for it a long time ago. But now I got it here, I ain't letting you go, you gotta get it. You understand what I'm saying? Because when I do this, your blood is off my shoulder. So he could talk, he could see, he could recognize in hell, you know, in hell. Look at the next verse, verse 25. But Abraham said, son, remember, I hope you don't find yourself in hell. And here, son, remember when you went to Peg Welcome in the church? You remember when you went to that funeral? You remember the preacher that was keeping a lot of noise that you were getting really upset with him because you think he wasn't dignified? Son, remember, this is the rich man, that you in your lifetime receive good things, Lazarus received evil things, but now he is comforted and you are tormented. Just a few more verses. Verse 26. And Abraham said, but nonetheless, between you and me, there's a great gulf. I can't come to you now. You can't come to me. You've already decided which side of the fence you want to be on, and it can't be changed. Now you're in hell. And the next verse says in verse 27, then this rich man is still trying to be argumentative. You can't argue yourself out of hell. You can't reason yourself out of hell. He says, I beg you then. This is what the rich man is saying, who's in hell. I beg you then. I got five brothers that they have not died yet. Send somebody from down here in hell and tell them don't come down to this place, for it is a place of torment. This man is trying to evangelize from the wrong place. He should have talked to his brother before. He waits till he gets to hell now to say, send somebody to tell my brothers, don't come to this place of torment. So you wonder why we're out on the streets at night. And you wonder why we're out there with microphones. You wonder why we handle tracts. You wonder why we do these things. Now you know why we do these things. Send somebody from hell. So Abraham is going to talk to me. Next verse. Abraham said to them, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them. You don't understand what I mean at all. So let me tell you what that means in simple Bajan language. They have the preachers and the Bible. Let them listen to them. So the preacher and the Bible is important for you to go to heaven. So the devil knows that, And he wants you to talk with the preachers all the time. They're so bad and everybody, they're worse than anybody, because the devil knows that you have to have a preacher and a Bible to get to heaven. So the devil is tricking you. Don't mind them preachers, all you want is money. Ask me, we can't pay for the car. What money? What money? Oh, if you want money, open a church. Oh, yeah? Oh, you think it is so? So the devil knows that if you could tear down the preachers all the time and split up the church and stop people from coming to church, he is satisfied with that. Because you have to have Moses and the prophets. The Bible says, listen to the preachers with the Bible. When last have you listened to a preacher with the Bible? But he's going to still argue. I'm going to finish this now. He's still going to argue. Look at it. And he said, no, Father Abraham. This is the rich man. No, but if one went from the dead back to life, my five brothers will repent. Are you waiting on that? Don't wait. So Abraham is going to respond to him. And Abraham said unto him, if they don't hear the preachers in the Bible, if they don't hear the preachers and the Bible, they will not hear even if somebody left hell and went back to life on earth. The preachers and the Bible were imparted to you. Some of you Christians sitting in front of me won't even come to church. You want to be on Zoom. Zoom is not church. If you go to motor services and they have every part for a motor car in their barn house, if they don't put it together, you ain't got no car. You got parts. You don't have a car. Anybody understand what I'm saying? Now, let me make it simple then. If you have okras and salt and meal and water, if you don't put it together, you ain't got no cuckoo. So you got the church with one in that house, one in that house, one in that house, one in that house, laying down in bed, say they're listening to Zoom. You zooming, huh? You zooming. You better be careful. You have one time to make it into eternal life. You have one time. Eternity is very long. Eternity is very long. Verse. They have Moses and the prophets. They have the preachers and the Bible. Well, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, Abraham said, neither will they be persuaded if one came from the dead. So what is your choice? Nobody's going to take your choice from you. God doesn't even force you to serve him. He's not that type of God. The choice is yours. And the messenger said to tell me to tell you that if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll be saved. The messenger told me to tell you that if you ask Jesus to come into your life, 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10 tells us, I think I have the right verse, 1 Corinthians 5, 10, it tells us that we must all, no, you think you're going to be left out? 1 Corinthians, I don't want that word, right? 1 Corinthians 5 and 10, you think you're going to be left out? This one said that we must, see the English language, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone, all those words speaks of individuality. You don't come with your family. Husband doesn't come with wife. You don't come as a family and bring the children. You're going to stand before God. And unlike some of our people who misbehave on the roads in Barbados, when the judge charges them $10,000, they pull $10,000 out of their pocket, they go to the cashier and pay, and they swear, go out to the court like nothing happened. Not this court. You're going to pee your pants. Not this court. We must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Every one of us is individual. Why? That we may receive the things done in our body. You're not going to pay for me. I'm not going to pay for you. Stop worrying about the hypocrites in church. If we have 125 hypocrites in church here, we have room for one more. And number two, if you can't live with 125 hypocrites here, how are you going to manage in hell with billions? How are you going to manage the hell with billions? Tell me that. I see people making every effort to go to hell because they don't understand what hell is like. Make excuses, the church this and the church that. You're going to be accounted for what you have done, whether it be good or bad. Revelation chapter 22 and verse 12 says, behold, I come quickly, which means I'm coming soon, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. So if you know deacons and pastors and all them that are hypocrites and are bastards and every word that you could think to make them look bad, it does not matter. You're going to give an account for what you did. You're not going to give an account for the pastor's life. You're not going to give an account for the deacon's life. No, none of that. You're going to give an account for your own life. Man, I said, glad I said this morning. I'm so glad I was able to deliver this message. So I'm able to go back to the messenger and say, yeah, they came today. And I was able to tell them what you told me to tell them. Did anybody get anything today? Is anybody going to change their life? Are you going to stop cussing the preachers? Are you going to contribute some money to the work of the ministry here? Are you going to come visit us sometimes? Huh? Are you going to give us some money? In a few minutes, I'm going to ask the ushers to come. I don't do this. I've been here for 37 years and I have not done this 10 times yet. Plus, I don't charge for funerals. I don't charge for weddings. I don't charge for counseling. Everything about here free. So if an offering plate comes in front of you, let me give you some advice for that. We don't do this too often. If you're going to write 1,000, there are 3 zeros after the first digit. 3 zeros and a full stop. You understand? If you're going to put money in, recognize that the tens and the fifties are very close. And realize that the twos and the hundreds are very close. I want you to spend some time with the group sing. I want to spend some time to look at it carefully and make sure. The Lord said, give and it will be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and run up. But listen, I don't want money to distract you from what I was just saying. You have one chance, and your chance could end today. One drunken fool on the highway, and you dead. One man with a big 40-foot container coming around the roundabout, and because you have the right of it, you think you should go ahead, you're going to be dead right. You go in the gas station tonight and some idiot with a gun put a bullet through your right eye. You didn't plan for that. He expected another 36 years. The average for man in Barbados is 72, 73. He expected another 36. You're expecting another 36. But are you going to get there? Today is your day. I want to close your eyes and bow your head. And in your own way, talk to the Lord. And say, Lord, if what that man, I don't mind if it will say, you ain't gonna say, Pastor. Lord, if what that man says is true, I'm hung up to dry. Lord, if what he said is true, I'm on my way to hell. If what he said is true, and believe me, I read it from the Bible, it is true. You don't come to church so often, so you don't know what I've just read. That's why we take opportunities at funerals to let you know. You gotta make your call in the election, sure, man. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved in thy house. Then start to come to church. Learn to pray. Learn to worship. Learn to sing unto the Lord. Learn to live a good life. Mortify the flesh. Put away the sins of the flesh. And one of these days, you will not be at that judgment that I just read about. But you will be at the bema seat. And you will be in a good place where God will say to you, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, today is a tough day for us. Accepting the fact that in the next few minutes we're going to be saying our farewell to the deceased is so difficult. But we choose to worship you and celebrate his life. You have called back into your presence. Fill this funeral service with your presence. Let your light shine upon our hearts, that we may be able to give our last respects lovingly. Let your grace be upon each individual that is in this place. We pray in the powerful name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Let us stand as a group, come and lead us in our final in church hymn, which is Amazing Grace. The ushers are going to come, even on the outside. Please help us to keep this gospel going. God bless you.
Amazing grace, how Singing worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Your holy name. Bless you, Lord. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never.
Faithfulness, morning by morning. I'm wings afar to the fragrance of spring. Every creature unique in the song that it sings, all its claiming. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing. Lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow. Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom.
Ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be. And when I think that
life and one still. In the midst of life, we are in death. Of whom may we seek for succor, but of thee, O Lord, who for our sins are justly displeased. Yet, O Lord most holy, O Lord most mighty, deliver us not into the bitter pains of eternal death. I am he that liveth and was dead, saith the Lord, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Let's say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, O Lord, our compassionate Father, who alone can heal the broken and heartened, bind up their wounds. Grant unto thy sorrowing children the peace and comfort of thy loving care, we beseech thee, so that with patience and with trust in thee, they may learn to abide the changes and the losses of this mortal life and the afflictions with which we are afflicted in this world. Give to them thy sustaining grace, that they may live in hope of the life everlasting, and be granted to consummate their lives in peace with thee, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now, unto the mercy of Almighty God, we commend the spirit of our departed brother and commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, dust to dust, ashes to ashes, looking for the general resurrection at the last day, when those who die in the Lord shall be raised to eternal glory and an endless life of joy and peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labor, and their works do follow them. Let us sing, Because He Lives.
This is my story. Lord, thou who art the God of all comfort, look with compassion upon all those who are at this time bereaved and whose hearts are heavy with grief. May the tie that has been broken on earth bind them closer to thee and to their loved ones and to each other. Grant that they may offer themselves in dedication to thy service, submitting themselves in patience and trust to thy holy will. Cause every one of us, O God, to consider the uncertainty of life, that we may live in readiness for thy call to us. May the day of thy return be a day of welcome and gladness. Enable us by the gracious indwelling of the Holy Spirit to continue in faith and in thy service to the end of our earthly days, that we may reign with thee throughout all eternity through Jesus Christ our Lord. And may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and remain with us now and always. When the roll is called up yonder is the next song.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning grace eternal bright and fair.
When the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
On the bright and cloudless morning,
and the glory of his resurrection share.
When his chosen ones shall gather from their home beyond the skies,
and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll is called up yonder, when the
the daughter said,
Yeah. Jesus.